business in Greece, the cleaner told me with great pride. Early morning on the following day, I had to leave the arrivals area. Even the word seemed to mock me. It was mid-September, and there were no more charter flights coming in from the UK, and no possibility that you would suddenly appear, as I allowed myself to fantasize. You didn't pick up when I phoned, but I knew that if something terrible had happened, then one of your friends would have called me. I sat for a while on a bench outside the airport, not knowing what to do or where to go. A few moments later, my phone buzzed. There was a message. I was shaking so much as I reached into my pocket that the mobile fell to the ground. Through the spider web of the shattered screen, I could just make out the words, "She can't make it, sorry." I suppose you had dictated it to some friend. I stared at it in the sickened disbelief for a few minutes and then rang the number. No reply. Several times I tried, of course, with the same result. Anger, fury, rage. Those words don't get close to describing what I felt. They are just words, puffs of air, nothing. There were no further messages, just a bon voyage from my brother late that day. I could have gone straight back to Athens, but I couldn't face driving back along the same road that I had just travelled with such anticipation and excitement. I was numb, almost incapable of getting the key in ignition. I had no real idea where I was going. I didn't care. I have no idea how long I drove. When I got to the sea, I stopped. Right on the beach, where the road ran out, there was a sign saying, "Rooms." This was where I would stay. I did almost nothing in the days that followed except sit and gaze out at Ionian. The waves were wild, endlessly rolling in and crashing on the sand, their mood reflecting the turmoil that I felt inside. It did not seem to subside. I could not eat or speak. Men are meant to be the stronger sex, but I have never felt so powerless. I think the sea would have dragged me in if I'd got too close. Some days I would willingly have disappeared beneath the foam. I could not stand looking at the torment of my phone over and over and over again, seeing the blank, unbroken screen. So I took it out of my pocket and threw it as far into the ocean as I could. It was liberating. The moment I saw the splash, I had to accept that I would not and could not hear from you. I was cut off from you now, and cut off from the world too. God knows what the nice couple around the place in Methoni thought of me, but they left a plate of cold food each evening and took it away each morning. The wife put a bunch of fresh flowers in my room one morning and changed them when they wilted. All I could do was register their kindness, but not much else. I did not feel hunger or thirst. Even temperature did not register with me. One day I stood under the shower until the water ran cold, but realised I could feel nothing on my skin. My watch told me that an hour had passed, despair depriving me of my senses. They were dark days. How I passed the time, I don't know, but somehow the hours went by. I had no awareness of how many days or weeks it was since my wait at the airport. But one day, the owner of the pension greeted me as if I was on my way out to the beach. "Calamina," he said cheerfully. "Octobrumris. It's a new month." I had been there almost a fortnight. The schedule that I had mapped out for us seemed ridiculous now. A tour of the Bello Panese, then a ferry to Kythera, and from there another ferry to Crete before you flew back to Athens and then to London. You said you had exactly 2 weeks' holiday to spare, and my meticulous planning would have made sure you were back in time. I had bought a ring while I was in Athens, a solitaire diamond from a shop called Solotas. This is how much I had deceived myself. I had planned to propose to you against the blood-red sunset in the west of Crete. Even now, I sometimes find myself replaying a scene that would never happen. I hope that one day it will fade from my mind forever. That evening in Methoni, where I'd close my shutters against the sunset. I had to make a decision, a return to London or to travel alone. My research in Athens during the 2 weeks I was there had gone well. The curator, the Museum of Cycladic Art, had been wonderful, opening up many parts of the archive for me, so I had plenty of material to start writing my book. I could do this in a hotel room as easily as at home. The thought of London slightly chilled my blood, as I knew I'd be looking for your face in every crowd. Another good reason to stay in Greece for a while would be to avoid the melancholy of British autumn. So I packed my bag and checked out. I was in no hurry now. I called my brother from a phone box in the village and asked him to pick up my post once a week and deal with any bills. I did not know how long I would be away. The advance of my book contract would last me a year if I was careful. Before going into the general store to get chocolate, chewing gum, some water and a few other things I needed for the road, I paused at a rusty carousel where a few desktop postcards were displayed. The shopkeeper was probably not expecting many more tourists now, so he had not bothered to replenish his stock. I picked out one of the Venetian castles to which in all those days there I had not bothered to visit. Sorry. Why did I do that? I didn't imagine that you cared about where I was, but I had a sudden desire to communicate with you. Perhaps it was simply to break through the silence that now existed between us. Or was it just to alleviate my loneliness? I couldn't be the person playing with a mobile and appearing to have friends and arrangements, but I could be the man busy writing a postcard and needing to find a stamp. It would be a way to talk to you without expecting any reply. A one-way conversation. The idea pleased me. Perhaps you might even regret that you had not come. The man in the shop put several stamps on the card for me, then packed up the other things I had brought. Wishing me a good journey. I rested the card on the roof of the card, scribbled a few lines to you and tossed it into a nearby postbox. I was totally at liberty to go anywhere I pleased, but it was strange how discombobulating such freedom can be. I sat in the car for at least an hour staring at the map, and it took all my will to put the car in gear and drive. I knew I was heading east because the sea was behind me, but I had no fixed destination and no idea where instinct or fate would take me. It was the beginning of my travels, and that's all I knew. In the following weeks and months, everywhere I stopped, people talked to me. Most were warm and kind, and if they were not immediately so, then my attempts to speak Greek would often break the ice. Many of them told me stories. I listened and noted it down, each day learning surprising things about this country and new things about myself. The voices of strangers poured into the void, filling the silence you'd left. You will recognise some of the locations in the stories from the postcards. Who knows if the tales people told me are true or false? I suspect that some of them are complete fabrications, others are exaggerations. But perhaps some of them are real. You can't decide. The size of my stepping stones are smooth and gleaming clean, and even on a cool autumn evening, beautiful buildings on all four sides protect you from the slightest breeze. The walls of this room are a montage of Greek history, a former mosque from 16th century, a Venetian arsenal, graceful neoclassical buildings, and some reasonable 20th century architecture. Situated on the sea with three castles and a history that stretches right back to ancient times, Navplio was the first capital of the modern state of Greece from 1829 until 1834, and it feels like somewhere that matters. I spent many hours there watching the world go by. I was glad of some conversation on one of my evenings in Navplio, and the couple that spoke to me could not help commenting on the fact that I was alone. "Your wife," asked the woman, "isn't she with you?" So many assumptions were made in this question, but I did not bother to address them. Fortunately, her husband stepped in, sensing that his wife had been a little blunt. Ever since the Ardemacles affair, people in Navplio have been a little wary of men who sit on their own. Thank you.